My talk will focus on a form of artistic practice that became particularly evident in the period around 1990 and could be examined in joint exhibitions. In this respect, my contribution can also be regarded as a case study in the field of exhibition research. In the art of this period, some major shifts took place that became visible on a number of levels. Artistic strategies were developed that aimed to take art outside its conventionally assigned framework or space, and also to fictionalize the role of the artist by overlaying it with other areas of activity. Such measures were required if an artistic intervention was to engage not only with the public realm, but also with extremely diverse social environments. Where is art heading? This question is frequently asked with genuine curiosity in relation to current art, and it also determines museum exhibitions, art fairs, studios, and gallery displays are viewed and explored. In the period around 1990, Berlin was a key location in this respect. With the fall of the Berlin Wall and the end of the DDR in 1989, the city not only lost its insular status, it also experienced the direct confrontation between two artistic worlds or contexts which at different levels had already made attempts to come together: art in the West and its counterpart in the East. I would like to start by addressing just one aspect of this rapprochement in order to recall how things stood at this pivotal moment in history. In summer 1989, the art historians and curators, Eugen Blume and Christoph Tannert, were commissioned by the DDR authorities to organize a program of art events in East Berlin, with a specific emphasis on presenting actions and installations. These events took place over several days at Galerie Weiße Elefant on Almstadtstraße near Alexanderplatz, as well as in various artist studios in Prenzlauer Berg. Here you can see Christoph Tannert in the center, with Eugen Blume to his left, along with the artists Via Lewandowski at front right and Erhard Munden at front left, during their own action entitled Kommunikationsstörung. I attended many of these events, not just to support my colleagues and see the artists' works, but because I regarded it as an exercise in normality to engage in an artistic dialogue with the eastern part of the city. This involved traveling from my apartment in West Berlin in the evenings to take part in the events. The events that took place at the Galerie Weiße Elefant were above all installations and performances by the so-called Autoperforationsartisten, a group of stage design students from Dresden University of Fine Arts. Against this theatrical background, they were able to expand their concept of art to include installations and actions. Micha Brendel, Else Gabriel, Via Lewandowski, and Rainer Görs were among the members of this group. Here you can see a joint performance by Via Lewandowski on the right and the writer Durst Grünbein on the left. It was called Deutsche Gründlichkeit and involved collecting beads of sweat in tiny bottles. So, what was happening in the West at this time? In West Berlin, long before the wall came down, the artists Rebecca Horn and Janice Cornelis, together with the playwright and theater director Heiner Müller, had developed a concept of a group show. It was not intended to be a large-scale exhibition, but was to involve projects taking place simultaneously in locations across East and West Berlin. When this project was being planned, nobody could have imagined that when it was finally implemented as die Endlichkeit der Freiheit, in 1990 the organizational team would include both East and West Berliners. Via Lewandowski was one of the artists invited to take part and later described his contributions as follows, quote, "It all started actually with my first really important entry to the Western art scene at the exhibition Die Endlichkeit der Freiheit. I was asked to do a piece connecting the East and the West. For this project, I worked with two very important historical sites. One was the Column of Victory in West Berlin, and the other one was the Finance Ministry located in East Berlin." End of quote. Lewandowski's work for the exhibition focused on two murals created by other artists. A socialist realist mural by Max Lingner on the exterior of the Haus der Ministerien in what had been East Berlin, and a glass mosaic by Anton von Werner on the Victory Column in the Tiergarten District of West Berlin. Lingner's mural, entitled Building the Republic, was made out of Meissen porcelain tiles between 1950 and 53. The glass mosaic created by the history painter Anton von Werner, on the other hand, which is installed on the wall of the portico at the base of the Victory Column, had been produced in 1876 by a company in Venice. Via Lewandowski took a rubbing of this glass mosaic and used the resulting canvas to conceal Lingner's mural on the Haus der Ministerien in East Berlin, as you can see in this photograph. The mural on the Victory Column, meanwhile, was covered with white fabric so that when it was illuminated, it appeared to be a blank surface. Lewandowski said about this piece, quote, "After I had taken the photage on a huge canvas, I covered the glass tiles image with a white material and lit it up. It now looked like a shiny, paper-white plane, an unwritten panel of history." End of quote. By the late 80s, the expansion of artistic media to include all kinds of new materials and diverse techniques such as photography, video, film, actions, objects, or installations was well established, as was a flexible approach to use of these media. Now, however, artists began to explore the issue of where to situate art, regarding this as a way of opening up new realms of artistic activities and hence new sites for their own practice. The 1990s, therefore, brought increased reflection on the place of artistic production and reception. The boundaries of the artistic sphere shifted as art left the confines of traditional settings such as galleries, Kunstvereine, or museums and established itself via the works themselves in a specifically defined locations within the social sphere. The phenomenon of artists determining their own sphere of activity and thus the context of their practice as part of the artistic strategy was particularly evident in the period around 1990. This was clearly demonstrated by the exhibition Integrale Kunstprojekte, often referred to simply as Integral, organized with the art association Neue Gesellschaft für Bildende Kunst in 1993, where 16 artists or artist group were invited to present works they had conceived in combination with a specific location. For this reason alone, the exhibition extended across the public sphere, or more precisely, a variety of social environments, as all of the selected works were realized in the places for which they had been specifically conceived. One work, for example, was presented in cinemas as part of their normal pre-feature program. The Berlin-based artist Albrecht Flieger produced a trailer whose cast convincingly raised expectations for a film that did not actually exist. Flieger produced the trailer on 35mm film, and as its director, he collaborated with professional partners in the film industry, actors, cinematographers, technicians from the film lab, Ari Contrast, among others. Filming was done in various locations, including a hospital. The trailer had a state-of-the-art Dolby stereo surround soundtrack and was shown in 10 different cinemas across Berlin. The montaged sequences indicate that this film, with its European Latin American title, Hernandez Dom, Der Kampf den IR, is a work of science fiction. Although we do not have surround sound system here, I'd like to take this opportunity to show you Flieger's work from 1993.
Der König sieht eine Sau, die frisst Eicheln, sagt der Oberförster zum Unterförster. Komm, gib mir eine Kugel mit Herz.
Die Gerüchte über geheime Stationen in der Stadt nehmen zu.
Wie ist sein Zustand, Dr. Hayashi?
Im C4 war für eine Sekunde eine Reorganisation zu sehen.
Gibt es noch mehr Zeugen?
Er ist der Letzte, aber es liegt eine Alpha-Order vor.
Bereiten Sie 2 Milliliter Celestin vor.
Stoppen Sie!
Das ist keine Reorganisation.
Das Problem ist zu komplex. Wir können ihn nicht sterben lassen.
Die Repräsentanten waren kurz vor dem Ziel. Sie beschlossen, jede Erinnerung an die Vorgänge auf der Ostseite zu löschen.
Und das Personal?
Von den verbleibenden Mitarbeitern wird keiner die Station verlassen. Sobald wir mit ihnen draußen sind, wird die C-Ebene für immer versiegelt.
Erst jetzt begann ich zu begreifen, wer Dom wirklich war.
Fangen Sie an. Alle Varianten gleichzeitig.
A very different project was carried out in the DIY section of 2 Karstadt department stores, one in the district of Wedding and the other on Hermannplatz in Neukölln. Fritz Heisterkamp created 2 different versions of an object and had these reproduced in the manner of an artist's multiple. Rather than presenting his work in an art context, however, he offered them for sale in the DIY section of 2 shops. A promotional video was screened near the object, outlining their special features and how to use them. Customers could choose between the Bornholm Hobby and the Bornholm Profi for 89 or 99 Deutschmarks, respectively. In this photo, you can see the display and integration of Heisterkamp's work into the department store setting with a promotional video running and the background and the two different devices at the front. Shoppers would pass by without immediately noticing the misappropriation of this object. The credible presentation of possible applications for this nonsense item made it seem feasible as a consumer's product, until closer inspection revealed the functional dysfunctionality and absurdity of the object, hence of many other items to offer. Irene and Christine Hohenblüchler carried out their project in another very different setting, namely in the secure forensic unit of the Karl Bonhoeffer Nervenklinik, a psychiatric hospital in the far north of Berlin. The twin sisters from Austria conceived their work as a workshop involving patients in his forensic unit. In collaboration with the patients, the artist subsequently mounted an exhibition in the occupational therapy building, where new works were shown alongside existing objects that had been produced individually or jointly. As you can see here, these range from painted pictures, sculptures, cabinets, and everyday objects to audio tapes or articles of clothing. The title given by the Hohenbüchlers to their workshop reflects their concept of multiple authorship, which involves creating a framework within which the participants can choose what they wish to communicate and to convey. In this way, aspects of life on the social periphery are brought into the public sphere. The form of artistic practice that has already become evident in these first three examples from the 16 projects in the exhibition Integral also has far-reaching consequences for the relationship between artist and viewer. By being conceived for a particular context within the social sphere, the artworks are also aimed at specific recipients. This artistic strategy clearly departs from any kind of dependency upon visitor numbers, as the works have an intent or target audience. In the three projects I have described, these were cinema goers, department store customers, and patients in a psychiatric clinic. Carsten Höller's action was aimed simply at passers-by in public spaces. He had actors run naked through pedestrian zones on Wilmersdorfer Straße in West Berlin and on Unter den Linden in the East. His work was a public performance that reenacted sociological phenomenon from the 1970s in the context of art. Due to the nature of the project, Höller's contribution naturally attracted a lot of media attention. The streetcars were regularly stopped by the police, as you can see here. The protagonists, who seemingly represented a public nuisance, were released when they provided proof that they had permission to carry out this art project. You can see here that the two actors also wore red contact lenses to give them an alien appearance as they ran through the streets. Due to the diverse approaches adopted by the participants in this exhibition, the context and subject matter of the assembled projects were also highly varied. by integrating his theories of dysfunctional artistic objects into the functional consumer world of a department store, for example, Fritz Heisterkamp addressed the idea of art as a commodity, i.e. the art market, but at the same time he explored the mechanism of the Western economic system and provided a critique of consumerism by questioning the notion of usefulness. A body of work developed by the artist Ingo Günther in the early 1990s meanwhile dealt with a global problem, or as he described it as the time, a global opportunity, namely refugee movements around the world, and above all, the statelessness of refugees. Günther, who is now based in New York City, presented his proposal on this subject in the form of an art project. Showing remarkable foresight, he proclaimed an international refugee republic and created a logo for this state which bears a striking resemblance to that of an internationally recognized status symbol. As you can see here, the representative logo was displayed on flags on Ernst Reuter Platz, a prominent public square in what was formerly West Berlin. For the duration of the exhibition, a refugee republic embassy was set up as a point of contact on the premises of the Berlin daily newspaper Tagesspiegel, which were then on Potsdamer Straße. The background to Günther's work was also provided by a new technological development that he put to artistic use, the internet. The artists built a website on which he published statistics on refugee numbers, lists of trouble spots, and cartographic maps of refugee flows. As I mentioned earlier, the themes addressed in the exhibition Integral were extremely diverse due to the fact that they reflected the specific concerns of the respective artists rather than being imposed or defined by us, the curators. The curatorial engagement consisted of bringing together projects which, first of all, already existed, and secondly, involved determining the site of realization in conjunction with the work itself. The aim of the exhibition, therefore, was to highlight this particular artistic method and to implement a series of such projects at the same time. Yes. A joint event being staged across multiple locations, some kind of transport link. To this end, we commissioned Ingold Airlines, a project by the Swiss artist Dres Ingold, who now teaches at the Academy of Fine Arts in Munich. The fictional airline was established in 1982 and consists only of logos and a corporate identity and promotional materials. For the exhibition Integral, Ingold set up an Ingold Airlines shuttle service to provide transport for visitors between the various projects. At the Neue Gesellschaft für Bildende Kunst, an Ingold Airlines counter was installed where visitors could book their place on one of the two different routes of the shuttle service to travel on a bus called the Lift Tax. The shuttle service could be booked with this boarding pass connecting the different venues to the exhibition. Another interesting aspect of this concept of art becomes apparent here. Not only have the artworks featured in this exhibition defined and limited their own target audiences by being conceived for and tied to specific sites, the artists also have a different conception of their own role. Artists working in this manner are always called upon to play additional occupational roles. In the exhibition Integral, these included the role of a film director in Albrecht Flieger's cinema project, that of workshop leaders in a psychiatric clinic in Hohenbüchler's project, and that of travel agent in Rees Ingolds' work. This form of creative practice, therefore, involves a shift in the artist's understanding of their own role. One of the stops on the shuttle bus route was a Plattenbau, an apartment block made of prefabricated concrete, typical of serial construction in East Germany. Rainer Oldendorf's project, Studio Cinema, took place in an East Berlin Plattenbau of the type QP71 near Moritzplatz. As you can see here, an object was installed outside a window on the seventh floor of the building. Despite its futuristic appearance, this fixture had a very practical application. It projected video images from outside onto the window pane. Using video projector and mirrors, Oldendorf had developed a construction whereby the projection could be aimed at the outside of the window. From the apartment, therefore, one no longer looked out at the surroundings, but instead viewed video footage. The window thus served as a kind of cinema screen. The footage shown was produced as a work in progress over the course of the exhibition. Rainer Oldendorf used the rented three-room apartment as an open studio in which he, the artist, played the role of a scientific researcher. In discussions with experts such as architects, as well as with visitors or friends, he explored the sociological conditions and aesthetic influences under which we live and recorded the conversations on film. In this way, Oldendorf, who was presented at last year's Documenta 14, conducted a discursive art project addressing the topic of living in a serial housing complex. The title of Oldendorf's work, Studio Cinema, described the idea of transforming the living space and thus this temporarily occupied studio into a cinema, or indeed regarding it as such. In this project, he developed an artistic form where the research site and the exhibition site were connected and in fact became identical. In my brief presentation, I've outlined how, at the turning point of the early 1990s, the exhibition Integral brought together 16 examples of an artistic phenomenon that led to significant shifts multiple levels and were based on the principle of immersion in diverse social environments. After it had become commonplace during the 1980s for visual artists to embrace all kinds of media and technologies, increasing consideration was given to the idea of simultaneously defining the setting of an artwork, i.e. the situation upon which it is focused and the place where it is ultimately intended to be, have an effect. The exhibition Integral documented attempts by artists to take art outside its traditional sphere. The field of action was purposefully transposed from the space traditionally reserved for art into the wider realm of society. Through the openness to new media that had already been achieved, the entire vocabulary of social activity could thus become the material of art. This spatial displacement of art also introduced the possibility of determining a precise thematic position for the respective artistic intervention. In this way, art defined its framework of meaning. A striking feature of this concept of art is the fact that the spatial shift also leads to transformations or modifications on the part of the viewing audience. And the artists themselves, as far as viewers are concerned, this is because the target audience is limited to the specific group of people the project addresses. Of fundamental importance, however, is a shift that takes place in the self-image of artists, as their conception of their own role must expand to include other occupations. As we have seen in the works featured here, this might lead to them acting as a film director, a travel agent, or an advertising professional. Ultimately, this represents a confrontation between the real world and an artistic fiction. It only becomes problematic for our society when reality begins to employ the strategies of art and no longer has a problem in accepting fiction, for example, in the form of fake news. That brings me to the end of my talk. Thank you very much for your time.